Welcome to this special edition of Go Vote Omaha. This is a primary election candidate forum for the Omaha City Council, Districts 1, 6, and 7, presented by the League of Women Voters of Greater Omaha. I'm Jerry Simon, a League member and moderator for the forum. The League of Women Voters never supports or opposes political parties or candidates. We present this forum solely for voter education. Here's the format for our forum this evening. Each candidate will have a one-minute opening statement. We'll follow that with questions and answers. And you can call in your question. The number is on your screen, so please do that. We'd hope to take as many viewer questions as possible. Each candidate will have up to 90 seconds to answer a question. And then after the question and answer period, we will have a one-minute closing statement by each candidate. Our timekeeper will signal the candidates when 30 seconds of time is remaining for them to speak and when to stop speaking. Before the forum this evening, the candidates drew lots to determine their initial speaking order, which will rotate throughout the forum. And I'll introduce them to you in that order now. We have six candidates here running in the district. One was unable to be with us this evening. The first candidate is Aimee Melton in District 7, Brian Thommes, District 7, Brinker Harding, District 6, and Grant Sturek, District 1, Paul Anderson, District 1, and Dwite Pedersen, District 6. Now we'll start with opening statements, beginning with Aimee Melton.
Thank you, Jerry, and I also want to thank the League of Women's Voters for hosting tonight's forum, and all of you for being here tonight. My name is Aimee Melton. I'm an attorney, a small business owner, working mom, and a former domestic violence prosecutor for Douglas County. 4 years ago, our city was headed down the wrong track. Spending was up, and the last mayor had passed massive tax increases. Violent crime was spreading, growing, and hurting Omaha's future and ruining lives. I decided to recruit a good candidate to run for the city council in District 7, a fiscal conservative, a candidate who would be tough on crime, rein in the union contracts, and make the hard decisions to keep spending and taxes down. Then my family encouraged me to run. We ran a grassroots campaign with my sister as my treasurer and my father as my campaign manager. And my friends went door to door. We won, and here's what we've done. We've turned Omaha's budget deficit into surplus. We have controlled spending. We've cut property tax rates twice.
Thank you. Brian Thommes.
I would like to thank the League of Women Voters for this forum. My name is Brian Thommes. I am a City of Omaha native. I've been here since I was 5 years old. I moved away for 5 years when I turned 24, and I've been in Omaha for 27 years. I went to Roncalli, UNO, and I live in the same house in District 7 that I grew up in. I currently live there with my partner, two cats, dogs, and chickens. After the last election, I really decided to get into politics. I've always been active in politics, but I really wanted to get involved and find a way to make Omaha the place that people want to come to. I wanted to find a way to get young people to stay in Omaha. I moved away because I wanted to get away from my parents, but I know a lot of friends and family that have moved away for jobs, and I want to find a way to get that into Omaha. I want us to find a way to improve our infrastructure and find a way to have sustainable growth.
Thank you. Now Brinker Harding, District 6.
Thank you, Terry. Good evening, and thank you to also to the League of Women Voters for hosting this event, and also for the viewers to watch and become informed so that you can make an informed decision for whom you're voting for in the city elections. My name is Brinker Harding, and I am the candidate for District 6. I'm running for two reasons. One, my family. My wife Rebecca and I have two kids, ages 14 and 11, and I want them to grow up in a city that's safe, that's affordable, that grows well, and is well managed. It's a good place to live, work, and raise a family, but I also want them to grow up in an environment where they can do the same. The second reason is my passion for public service. Whether it's work you do for your church, community service, or like me, running for city council, I think it's important to give back to the community. And I want to take my private and public sector experiences along with my passion for the taxpayer to focus on four things: safety, taxes, economic development, and basic city services.
Thank you. And in District 1, Grant Sturek.
Thank you very much, Jerry, the League of Women Voters, and to everyone else who's out there watching. My name is Grant Sturek, and I've lived in Omaha my entire life. Our city has a number of unique advantages: a low cost of living, good schools, and a friendly community with a spirit of giving back. However, our current leadership has failed to translate these advantages into sustained growth for the city. Our young people are leaving Omaha en masse because they don't think there are enough opportunities here. Our crime rate fluctuates drastically year to year with no sustained decline because we lack a cohesive solution to address the root causes of criminality. And our infrastructure is crumbling, with roads being ground into gravel because we failed to have the foresight to build them out of durable materials. You know, our leadership's contentment with stagnation and mediocrity directly contradicts our community slogan of "We don't coast." We need new, younger leadership to develop comprehensive and long-term solutions for Omaha's challenges. And that is precisely what I intend to do should you elect me as your next city councilman. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And also District 1, Paul Anderson.
Thank you, Jerry. My name is Paul Anderson. I want to thank the League of Women Voters of Greater Omaha for hosting this event. I am a long-standing resident of Omaha and native-born in the state of Nebraska. I am retired from the railroad and the U.S. Navy Reserves. I believe in old-fashioned values, serving God, family, and community. Even though I've long since retired, it is important for me to contribute where needed. I volunteer for the Salvation Army, Red Cross, and VA Hospital to support our wounded and aging veterans community, and I will forever work to preserve our land. I have no personal agenda other than to enjoy the best city in the world. Together, we can keep it that way.
Thank you. And running in District 6, Dwite Pedersen.
Thank you. Thank you, League of Women Voters, for having this forum. My name is Dwite Pedersen. I've lived in Omaha since 1964. I came here to work at Boys Town, which was a suburb of Omaha at that time. I met my wife here and have raised my family here. I've been privileged enough to be a state senator for four terms, in the Nebraska legislature from 1993 to 2008. It was an honor and a privilege to serve. I love serving people, I love working with people, and I would love to keep Omaha going on a straight line and make it even better. Thank you.
Thank you. Now we're ready for questions, and here's our first question, and Brian Thommes will answer first. Omaha has used a cost-cutting policy of converting unimproved streets into gravel unless adjacent property owners agree to help pay for some of the cost of resurfacing. In some cases, Public Works has stopped sealing cracks and filling potholes, which contributes to road deterioration. There's also a backlog on street resurfacing. How do you propose to address these street issues, and how do we pay for ongoing maintenance and street resurfacing?
As a city, we need to look at other sustainable sources. The thing that I've been researching and doing my research on, is plastic roads. We can recycle bottles, we can recycle tires, we can other petroleum uses and make them into roads. They are sustainable, they last long term, they're not down as long. Is it something Omaha can do? I think we should look into it. It will help us continue to build streets, and they should last longer. I don't think we need to tear our streets up. That's just making us, outside looking in, Omaha's already kind of backwards, so let's not do that. Let's look forward.
Thank you. Brinker Harding.
Thanks, Jerry. Well, it's interesting. I think there are more lane miles of streets in that condition in District 6. And it's not something that happened overnight, and certainly, unfortunately, the solution is not something that happens overnight. But I think I think some of the ideas that have been that have surfaced with the city and working with the neighbors of those affected to look at solutions and how those cost sharing results might take place. I think one of the great things is that the city is now working with the unicameral to be able to extend the amortization period of 10 years to 20 years for some of those improvements that might be needed. And I think that the city is trying to work on a solution that is that satisfies both parties, that being the city and the taxpayer. I think to work with them and find a solution is something that when both parties agree to, I think it needs to be applied to uniformly across the city. And I know the city's looked at contributing engineering costs and then having a split with the taxpayers if a street improvement district is approved by those affected in the neighborhood.
Thank you. Grant Sturek.
When I first read that article in the New York Times about how Omaha is turning streets into gravel roads, I was disgusted. Quite frankly, it's horrible PR for our city. That's not the sort of thing that I want people elsewhere to think of when they think of Omaha. The fact of the matter is, the citizens of Omaha are taxpayers, all right, the people who give up part of their income to make sure that we have basic city services. They are entitled to good roads, to durable roads. I've been knocking doors all throughout this campaign, talking to voters, listening to their issues, and one of the most common complaints I've heard is residents talking about, you know, massive potholes and cracks in front of their houses. And frankly, the city needs to engage in better solutions than simply grinding those roads into gravel and giving up on any attempt to make sure that our citizens have access to good roads. So one of my first priorities will actually be to go down to the Public Works Department and talk to the employees there and figure out, do you have the budget to make sure that the citizens of Omaha have the services that they are entitled to as taxpayers? And if they do not, then I will propose more additional funding to be allocated towards the Public Works Department, specifically to fix potholes, because this is one of the biggest and most annoying problems in our city and one that voters are constantly complaining about and have been for years.
Thank you. Paul Anderson.
I am a construction student at Metro Community College. I believe the city's street departments could probably improve our streets by examining, bringing to the table as to the kinds of materials that are used to do our street repair as well as our street construction. In other words, getting a bigger bang out of the tax dollars for the people of this city. Another thought is, as a retired railroader, I believe we should take a serious discussion, bring it to the table, and see if the city could benefit by having a rail car or a light rail system. That obviously would take a number of vehicles off our more traveled streets and lowering the need and lessening the use of our, especially the high traffic streets.
Thank you. Dwight Pedersen.
Thank you. Going door to door, obviously, roads is a big issue in the city of Omaha, at least in District 6. From neighborhood to neighborhood, you hear the same thing, our streets. There are some of the newer homes that have nice streets, but there's even some newer homes on bad streets. One of the things we need to do is put a little more brain power into what we're doing when we come spending dollars, the tax dollars, of our citizens. Roads are important. Without transportation, jobs are nil. Without transportation, we don't have our kids getting to school. It is very, very important that these roads get taken care of, and we need to get to the table and work it out now. I don't have a lot of answers when it comes to fixing roads, but I do know that what we already tax our people and what we charge them for is to keep the roads up and take care of our other services. We are bright enough, and it's a new enough age in our society that we can do better than what we're doing on roads. And that needs to be come to the table and worked out immediately. It's very important.
Thank you. Aimee Melton.
Thank you. And I'm going to stick to the question that was asked by the viewer, specifically about unimproved streets in our district. Currently, Omaha has about 4,800 lane miles. 300 lane miles are actually considered unimproved streets. In order to fix those, it's going to be at a cost to the taxpayers and or the residents on the street, a total of about $300 million. We do need to do something about these streets. This grinding up streets started with the prior mayor, and the city has put a moratorium on grinding up these unimproved streets at this point in time. We appointed a committee of stakeholders, which included a state senator, as Mr. Harding talked about, and that committee should have our recommendations on how we can at least start with some cost sharing, extend the payback time for the assessments from 10 years to 20 years, and we're hoping the legislature will do that for us during this term. And we need to make sure that the roads that were already ground up, especially the roads that were ground up without the residents' knowledge, that those are given a priority. And that's what we need to do. We have already put an additional $4 million into infrastructure since I got on council, working with the mayor and the budget, and we need to increase our spending on infrastructure even more. And we need to be concerned about these unimproved streets because there are about 300 miles, and we need to get started on assisting the residents in getting those streets fixed.
Thank you. Here's our next question. How important is further expanding our system of public mass transit to the development of Omaha? And we'll begin with Brinker Harding.
Well, I think that's an issue that I think a number of cities and a number of cities like Omaha that are growing and expanding that we all face. I know that with the city implementing the BRT or the bus rapid transit system, I think that's a great start. I know that there's been a lot of discussion on the light rail. I think it would be, first of all, we need to make sure that that is a transportation solution and not just a tourism solution. We need to make sure that along with the BRT and light rail, that they work economically or that we have a way to pay for them. And I think with the implementation of the BRT and the success of that, will then give further argument and support to a light rail system. So I think those are two of the issues that I think we can address as it relates to transportation. We can also take a look at expanding some of the other transportation issues, be it bike trails, bike lanes, but there are a number of opportunities that the city of Omaha has in their toolkit to look at solving some of these transportation issues.
Thank you. Grant Sturek.
So it's no secret that Omaha is facing rising transportation problems. As more of our citizens have moved out west, that's increased commute times, that's increased traffic. And I know for a fact that I dread the idea of driving west on Dodge between 4 and 6 during any sort of weekday. And these problems are only going to get worse as our city expands, and I definitely do hope to see our population expand rapidly. And in order to support that expanding population, we need to make sure that we have a comprehensive public transit solution that reaches all people in the city. So the Midtown 2050 project with the streetcar, that's a good start and something that I'd really like to see happen. But I think it's also important to make sure that we don't just have public transit in Eastern Omaha, that we don't just have public transit in Midtown Omaha. We need to make sure that every citizen in the city has access to quality public transit that they can use to commute to work and go shopping and frequent businesses without having to worry about using a vehicle. And as I've said, the most important thing when it comes to public transit is making sure that everyone in our city has equal access to it and making sure that it's affordable and of a very high quality, which is something that unfortunately we don't have now with our Metro bus system.
Thank you. Paul Anderson.
Going back to it, it's already been mentioned, the streetcar, the light rail, and being a retired railroader, the opportunity that I see with this issue would be, I look to the proposal with the new VA hospital. This is evidently a partnership between government and business corporations coming together to share the cost and therefore not creating as much of a tax burden to the taxpayers. I see that as a possible opportunity there. I retired from my job, which was in Lincoln, Nebraska, in the summer of 2013. How nice it would have been, I visioned, being able to get on a high-speed train and ride to Lincoln to my job. Something that, like that, that would be able to be connected to a light rail system, maybe in Lincoln and Omaha. The other, about a week ago, I heard the mayor talk about, it's been proposed that they, with the Metro bus system, they are, it's in the plans to have a bus go up and down Dodge Street, just for the traffic on Dodge Street. That's already in the works. And the beautiful thing about that is, it will be utilizing the roads that we already have in place. We won't have to create.
Thank you. Dwite Pedersen.
Thank you. For a city as beautiful as Omaha, and the great people that live here, our public transportation is not sufficient. We talk all the time about economic development. Wonderful. Economic development needs some backbone. Backbone is more than dollars. But dollars have to be spent in the right way. Transportation is necessity. I see many, many people who could have far better employment and jobs if they had decent public transportation. I believe one of the best things that ever happened to Omaha, believe it or not, is Uber. I've got people going to work and can afford to go to work who have not gone to work for years because they couldn't afford to get there. Transportation is just one of the backbones that we need to look at, roads and everything else that we talk about. It all comes together in the same pot. Thank you.
Thank you. Aimee Melton.
Thank you. And the question was about expanding mass transit in the city of Omaha. The BRT system that we're getting, which was actually majority of it was federally funded, I think is a great system. What the BRT does is it doesn't just connect urban areas to each other, but it connects the urban areas where the jobs are all the way out to West Omaha. We can go to North Omaha. We can go to South Omaha. With a system like the BRT, I think the important thing to do would be to expand the BRT system even more so that we can get to more areas of the city. The most important thing is that we can get people to where the jobs are. And that's why we need better mass transit. If we're just looking at something like a light rail system that just serves the urban core, I think we're selling ourselves short. We need to make sure that we're getting all the way out to North Omaha, potentially connecting into Bellevue so that we can get the people in South Omaha, North Omaha, and all over our city down to the urban core. I think the worst thing we could do is to spend money and throw money away on something which would have to reduce the cost that we're spending on infrastructure improvements so that we can pay for a light rail system that people end up not using, or that the expense of it is too great. What I would like to do is take the time to listen to my constituents, to review and research how much it's gonna cost, the revenue sources that are going to be able to pay for it, and I want to have that dialogue with my constituents before I make that determination.
Thank you. Brian Thommes.
As long as I can remember, Omaha's always been a commuter city for me. I've always had a car. I've always gone everywhere that I need to with a car. I go to big cities like Chicago, and I refuse to drive. The numbers that I heard from one group of people that I listened to was that Omaha was going to double by 2050, and if we do that, we need better transit. I actually agree with Aimee on the bus rapid transit. I've looked into the light rail. I think it's costly. It's not effective. The bus rapid transit, the question that I asked Metro was, or not Metro, Matt was, what's the expansion package? And they said right now it's going to run from 10th to Crossroads, West Roads, and that's great, but the people that need the jobs are in North and South Omaha. So how do we get them? And they said long-term that the bus rapid transit could become a grid. And I think if it's a permanent solution, the bus rapid transit is what Omaha needs to go to. It can be affordable, and it can provide economic growth just like the light rail. You've got your stations, you've got your buses, you've got people going where they need to go. And I think that's where Omaha needs to go.
Thank you. Here's our next question. Militarization of police forces is an issue of concern for many. Would you support a city ordinance to require our police department to get city council authorization to purchase or acquire surplus military equipment? Why or why not? And we'll start with Grant Sturek.
I would gladly support such an ordinance. Quite frankly, when it comes to fighting crime and making our streets safer, one of the most important things that we can do is make sure that our city government and make sure that our police department is working with community organizations and that police officers are on the ground. And when you have a highly militarized police force, a police force that has tons of tanks and tear gas that's ready to deploy at any moment, you definitely reduce that trust within the community. The fact of the matter is, police officers don't need tanks. And our police officers should not treat our high crime, low income areas as though they are an occupying military force. In order to reduce crime, in order to reduce gang violence, in order to reduce drug violence, we need to actually make sure that our police officers and other members of our community are on the streets, that they're talking to our young people, that they're going to schools, that they're going to community meetings, so that our community is more unified. So absolutely, I would support such an ordinance because I believe that it would make the city of Omaha safer, and I think it would improve the overall relationship between law enforcement and the people they are supposed to protect.
Thank you. Paul Anderson.
I believe I could not support that kind of an ordinance. And the short reason is we have a military, and they are trained to basically defend this country. We have to separate that reason from our civilian police forces. I don't believe that would be to turn our and train our police officers, our law enforcement, to be totally equipped to go into combat. I don't think that would be the wisest use of our taxpayers' dollars.
Thank you. Dwight Pedersen.
I'm not so sure I could support an ordinance like that, but I do believe and would support giving our police anything they need to have to get the job done. If it's a waste and just stockpiling of equipment that they aren't going to use, then obviously it's a waste of our dollars. If it's surplus equipment and they can get it free, even stockpiling it then is ridiculous. But we have crime out there that is getting very sophisticated, and they need a lot of sophisticated materials and equipment to fight it. Not necessarily does that mean a tank, but in some cases, believe it or not, it would mean armored vehicles. The weapons that are on the street, I can tell you, from where I work, are unbelievable. And we need to support our law enforcement and give them whatever they need to be on top of it instead of ever getting behind.
Thank you. Aimee Melton.
Well, our police department is not militarized, and they've never requested any tanks or anything else. Actually, what they've requested is new cruisers, maybe larger cruisers, so that they can actually get in and out of their cruisers without hitting their guns and everything that they have to carry. And that's what we've done. We provided new cruisers, we've provided body cameras, which the police wanted, which I think is very important for their safety and the safety of the citizens. But there's no need for this ordinance because any expenditures that are made by the police have to be passed by the city council anyway. So I don't see why we would pass an ordinance telling ourselves or future councils what they can and cannot do, because we already do that through the budget process by approving the mayor's budget, the CIP, which we approve, and then any individual expenditures. That's what you'll see on a weekly basis. On our agenda items, any of the expenditures that are made by the different departments that are over $20,000 have to be approved by the city council. So I just feel that there's not a need to pass an ordinance, and I'm not really sure what the definition of militarized is, because we do need to make sure that our officers have all the equipment that they need, that they have the guns that they need, that they have the cruisers that they need, and that they have the support of our city and our mayor.
Thank you. Brian Thommes.
I don't believe this ordinance would need to be in effect. I don't see Omaha's police force as needing to be militarized. And like Aimee said, they have to go through the city council for their budget anyway. So having to buy the tanks or whatever they feel they need, I don't see that as something that Omaha needs. I think they need the cruisers, they need the guns, they need everything to do their job. And if someday we need tanks for them to do their job, then I think we've gone as a society way down a wrong path. But I think Omaha police officers need the tools to do their job, and we need to get them in the right place to get their job done.
Thank you. Brinker Harding.
I knew there might be an issue coming, answering this question behind Aimee, because I too was going to talk about the procedure for approval of items that are needed by the police department. I don't think it's needed for that reason. Any expenditure over $20,000 would have to come to the city council anyway for approval. But having said that, I think we also need to make sure that we give our police chief the ability to come to us with strategies or equipment requests so that those could be considered. We need to make sure that our first responders, be it the police or fire department, are given the proper tools to effectively protect and serve our community. I think that's obviously one of the basic city services that we require. But then on the end of that, I'll also add that it was some time ago that there was an opportunity to get helicopters, and a lot of people thought that was a terrible idea. And I think now when we look up at the sky and we see Able One protecting and serving us, and we protect and serve and assist with other neighboring communities, I think it would be a hard decision to look back and say that helicopters were not a good solution.
Thank you. Here's a question from a viewer who asks, how can redevelopment be implemented so that it would benefit both old and new residents of the redevelopment area? Often residents are displaced and priced out of redevelopment areas. And we'll begin with Paul Anderson.
Redevelopment. In District 1, there's a redevelopment project that's been sitting there mostly vacant for quite some time. I'm talking about Crossroads Mall. I think the time for talk is over. As a councilman, this will be one of my key issues and focus to work with the owner, council, and the mayor to get this redevelopment project up and running. That is sitting there, it's in a key location, it's on Dodge Street. I definitely see there is tremendous economic potential with getting something done with Crossroads Mall.
Thank you. Dwight Pedersen.
Redevelopment is another issue in the city. We have neighborhoods that are going up with many, many millions of dollars with new structures and new businesses. And we have neighborhoods that are spoiling. Buildings are collapsing. There needs to be a lot more thought and time put into this whole redevelopment thing. Just moving west or moving further out of town, I think is good, but we also need to remember the other part of town. What we've done downtown Omaha is beautiful. The city of Omaha has done a great job with that. And I would like to see us continue to do that kind of work with these older neighborhoods that are going down. I think one of the saddest things in the world is to see somebody spend a lot of money building a new business and a year later it sits empty, broke. I think the city does not have to take the blame for that, but maybe there would be a little more time and effort put into the development before it went up. Thank you.
Thank you. Aimee Melton.
And I think the question was, how can we encourage redevelopment but not price out the people for in the areas that are being redeveloped? I think one of the things we could do is that when we're reviewing the TIF projects, tax increment financing, and we're giving some of those tax financing options, that we would actually encourage developers with additional incentives if they're building affordable housing. And that's not just low-income housing. We also have affordable housing, where you don't necessarily have to qualify for vouchers, but as long as you have an income where you're working, hardworking people, you have affordable housing that you can afford as a hardworking family. That's what we can do in Omaha to ensure that people aren't being priced out for redevelopment. We're doing that right now off 99th and Military, off Old Blair High Road. There's a project that's going in right there. It's in West Omaha, and it's for affordable housing. The people that live there will have to have a job, have to work, but yet they're not going to have to pay the high prices that you see in some other areas and other apartment buildings and developments. This is what we're talking about when we're encouraging development, and also make sure that we're encouraging the redevelopment not just in North Omaha and South Omaha, and that we don't have affordable or low-income housing in just North Omaha and South Omaha, but it's dispersed throughout our city.
Thank you. Brian Thommes.
Redevelopment and priced out of the neighborhoods, I guess when that comes to my mind, I think of like Benson and Blackstone, and those areas have seen the redevelopment, and as a homeowner, I would enjoy the redevelopment there because my home value would go up. I may not like the taxes on it, but my home value would go up. But in areas such as Crossroads, where we're trying to redevelop, if we redevelop that into an urban center for the city, I think that neighborhood can absorb that, and it should not price people out of their houses. Currently, where I'm at, and where Aimee just talked about, 90th and Fort has three businesses that have failed, and we keep moving westward. So I guess my big thing is to focus on the core of the city, and not focus so much on westward expansion, but focus on developing the areas of the city that we have and get them so that there's people living there and enjoying that part of the city.
Thank you. Brinker Harding.
Thank you. You know, the amount of redevelopment we've seen in Omaha's core has been tremendous. And I think the use of tax increment financing on most of those projects is really about the only tool we have today for those types of projects. But one of the things I think we must do is we must continue to look at the process that's involved for the development, for the developers in the development community as they look to invest and put their money at risk. By working with the planning department, by working with the city to make sure that the permitting process is more streamlined. We have examples of, typically now you have to go not only to the planning board to get waivers, but then you have to go to the zoning board of appeals to get a waiver. There's now in place a streamlined process where some of those typical waivers, which are generally always approved, get wrapped into one blanket application so that you don't have to go through those additional steps. And those additional steps take time, and time is money. And as we all know, if the developers aren't making their return on their investment, they're going to be less inclined to continue to develop.
Thank you. Grant Sturek.
Mr. Anderson brought up a very good point with the Crossroads Mall. And so before I answer that question, I'd just like to point out that 4 years ago, the District 1 incumbent promised to redevelop the Crossroads Mall, and demolition hasn't even started yet. And so we need to aggressively prioritize those sort of redevelopment projects so that jobs and commercial activity aren't leaving the Midtown area of Omaha. Now, when it comes to gentrification, redevelopment, and making sure that people aren't being taxed out of the area, I think that one thing that our city really needs to do, as Aimee mentioned, was the fact that we need to have greater access for affordable housing. You know, right now, Omaha has been pursuing many redevelopment projects, but we haven't seen a whole lot of work on making sure that people you know, who have lower incomes can actually afford to live in Omaha. And so there are many things that we can do to do to better the condition of those people. You know, we need to make sure that housing is of high quality and affordable at the same time, and we need to develop more of those projects and make sure that when we develop areas downtown, that, you know, people don't suddenly see their rent skyrocket. We need to make sure that, you know, if people do see their rent skyrocket and they suddenly can't afford to live somewhere, that they're able to come to the city and that the city is able to provide an affordable solution for them, so that we aren't developing in such a way that we're, you know, essentially evicting people.
Thank you. Our next question is, previously yard waste went to the Omagrove Center for composting. Now both trash and yard waste go to the landfill. Do you support or oppose that change? Should we go back to separate pickup? And we'll begin with Dwight Pedersen.
Thank you. The second issue that I hear the most from walking door to door is garbage, recyclables, and the yard waste. The recyclables and the yard waste, along with the trash, is being dumped in two different areas at this point. One is going to recyclable, and the yard waste is being put in with the other garbage. People don't know where it's going, so they aren't concerned about that much. But in the neighborhood, they really care about the way they've been treated with their garbage cans, recyclable bins, and trash thrown all over the place. Windy days, we have them trash bin, the recyclable bins. If there's anything light in there, it blows out. Obviously, it's not the job of the trash pickers up to, of those that pick it up, to pick up that trash there. But they could, there's a lot more could be done. The what the city is looking at now, I think, is a great idea, using the big dumpsters that the truck picks up with a heavy lid on it, dumps it into a chute where it does, where you do not have the mess, and it's much more convenient, and I think it'll be much more accepted by the people.
Thank you. Aimee Melton.
Well, I've toured both the city landfill, which is way out in western Douglas County, and I've toured the Omagrove facility, which is actually located south of Omaha in Bellevue. What I loved about the Omagrove is that we were composting our yard waste. I think that's great. We're actually recycling and composting, and it's a place where you can get very cheap, if not free, composting for your own yards for the people in the city. Now, when I went out to the landfill, though, I also saw how we were using the methane, recapturing the methane, and actually providing energy to over 4,000 homes, and that's just on the methane that they're producing right now. Both are extremely energy efficient. I think both have recycling in mind, whether we recycle the methane into energy or recycle the yard waste into compost. They're both great answers. The problem is the Omagrove costs $8 million more than sending all of the yard waste to the landfill. My initial thought was, why don't we split the city in half? Why don't we have East Omaha send all their yard waste to get composted and have West Omaha send it to the landfill while it continues to make energy? Unfortunately, we aren't able to do that. We have to provide just one service. So what it comes down to is just the cost. And what I look to do over the next couple months is talk to the people in my district to find out what they would like to do.
Thank you. Brian Thommes.
I think we need to bring Omagrove back. I do believe that we need to look at the cost. I think it's $1.25 a cubic yard. Do we need to raise that to offset the cost? We can make it more, we can raise the cost. As a businessman, I have to look at that. As a citizen of Omaha, I look at how are we impacting the environment as a city. The methane, I think it's a good idea, but it doesn't really, 4,000 homes in a city of 400,000 people doesn't really do much for me. In a city of 400,000 people, and we can go get compost that's gonna affect our yards, I see that as as an added bonus. I think living in the town I lived in Iowa, we had the garbage cans where the truck had to pick it up. And I think that would eliminate manpower, which then eliminates part of the cost. And I think if we moved as a city to that, it would affect the cost of OmaGrow. And I think that's where we should continue to go.
Thank you. Brinker Harding.
Thank you. So we have a contractor who's not living up to its end of the bargain. And I think that's unacceptable. I think we need to hold their feet to the fire. And if they can't perform, then there need to be penalties for that. Now, that being said, I know there is a pilot program going on in Omaha right now with the larger bins. I think I think the jury might be out on that and what the success or what the challenges of that program going forward might be. I think there are obviously some good elements to it. As was mentioned, you know, having lids on containers for the recyclables rather than have them newspapers and light objects that usually go in those bins blowing around the neighborhood, I think that's obviously a great solution. As it relates to OmaGrow and the composting, I'd love to see it separated. But I know we have to get into the cost-benefit analysis of that as well. And so I think as we finish the pilot program and assess the success of it, I think we'll see some of those results borne out. But we also must look at other communities and the great solutions they have. We can look at Atlanta, Georgia, and Rubicon International, and the smart technologies that they're using for the way they pick up the garbage and using those smart technologies, knowing where those pockets are that need additional help and additional assistance on those pickup days.
Thank you. Grant Sturek.
It's definitely good that the landfill is actually trying to recapture some of that methane. Unfortunately, the fact of the matter is they won't be able to recapture all of that methane. And so long as some of that methane is going to the atmosphere, that's frankly an environmental hazard for the people of Omaha and for the planet as a whole. Methane is an extremely destructive gas for the environment. We need to minimize the amount of that is being placed into the atmosphere so that, you know, our children, our grandchildren can be guaranteed to have a good environment to live in. So absolutely we should go back to using the OmaGrow. You know, one thing that Brinker mentioned, which I very much agree with, is the fact that, you know, we have waste collections contractors that aren't fulfilling their end of the bargain. And so one thing that I'd like to do on the city council is to renegotiate those contracts so that they're performance-based. All right, if there are days where you know, residents are constantly complaining about garbage pickup, if garbage pickup is late without any, you know, good weather-related reason for that, then frankly, they shouldn't be getting much because they're not putting up their end of the bargain. So I believe that we can offset some of the extra cost of OmaGrow by simply negotiating a better contract with our waste collectors that will either, you know, result in the city saving more money if service is substandard or better service for the people of Omaha. Either way, it's a win-win.
Thank you. Paul Anderson.
I am a conservative, and I care about our environment. Omaha needs to do a better job when it comes to their recycling service. We put way too much garbage in our landfill. I also favor having waste management going to a single operator system with our current waste collection.
Thank you. Well, we're at the end of our time for questions, and we're going to go to our closing statements from each candidate. Each candidate will have 1 minute to close. And we'll begin with one of our candidates running in District 7, Aimee Melton.
Well, thank you very much. I have really enjoyed my time on council over the last 4 years. I think we've made a lot of progress in terms of reducing crime. We're at an all-time 10-year low for our homicide rate. Our conviction rate is up and our clearance rates are up. And in fact, Omaha is one of the few cities in the country that is actually seeing a decrease in the crime rates. In addition, we see economic development going on all over our city. It's exciting to live in this time, and other people see it too. We were just ranked as number 6 for millennials in cities of our size. The young people are seeing it. Young people are coming back. They may leave for a little while, as I think maybe a lot of us have done, but they're coming back because Omaha has great jobs. Omaha has high-paying jobs, and I think Omaha is on the right track. We're decreasing crime, we're decreasing property taxes, and we've got economic development ahead. And so I'd ask for your vote on April 4th.
Thank you. And now another candidate for District 7, Brian Thommes.
I am asking for your vote because I'm looking to change the city, make it more generation friendly, bring the generations together, find a way to impact both the older generations, the younger generations, and merge them. We need to continue to lower our crime, continue to bring back our youth, but not forget that we need to focus on what we currently have. I see several areas of the city that need more work, and I think we've just let them fail. So I think we need to work as a city to bring that closer to improvement. Thank you.
Thank you. Running in District 6, Brinker Harding.
Thank you, Jerry. And thank you again to the League of Women Voters for hosting this forum, and I hope it's been informative for the people watching so that they can make an informed decision on April 4th. Omaha is an incredible community, and we are so blessed with all the positive things that are occurring here. Look across the skyline, and we see all the cranes, and that means that's an indication that our city's growing, and it's a city on the move. Much great work has been done, but there's a lot more heavy lifting to go. We need to do that in order to capitalize on this momentum. As I mentioned at the outset, there are four areas that I need to concentrate on as your 6th District Council member. Public safety is number one. Taxes, economic development, and basic city services. I believe my life experiences, such as working in the public sector as chief of staff to the mayor, 17 years as a commercial real estate professional with Colliers International, and my time as chairman of the Omaha Planning Board makes me uniquely qualified for this position, and 5 of the last 6 mayors are supporting my campaign.
Thank you. And running in District 1, Grant Sturek.
One issue that I wish we had gotten the time to discuss tonight is the issue of property taxes. As you know, the Douglas County assessor is raising property valuations and quite literally taxing people out of their homes. So one thing that I will prioritize as your next city council member is replacing the property tax with a new tax scheme that is more progressive and, you know, isn't drastically increasing the cost of living for the people in Omaha. With that, as your next city councilman, I will work tirelessly to create a new age of transparency, accountability, and prosperity for the people of Omaha. It's time for us to come together and press ever onwards. Strive ever forwards and climb ever upwards towards a better future for us and for our children. Thank you very much.
Thank you. District 1 candidate, Paul Anderson.
I'm Paul Anderson. I'm a Christian, conservative, and a Republican, in that order. As your representative on the City Council, my priorities will be fully accountable to all the citizens of this city. As a councilman, my priorities and focus will be the issues that are important to you, the taxpayers and voters. Some of these issues are taxes, streets, economic growth, trash pickup, public safety, town hall meetings, transportation, libraries, police and firefighters pension fund, Crossroads Mall, and gender ID. It is my position, if you are running for or hold elective office, all issues are relevant. Please go to my website, Paul Anderson. Sorry.
Thank you. Running in District 6, Dwight Pedersen.
I'm Dwight Pedersen, District 6. I want to thank the League of Women Voters
for having this forum. As I mentioned at the beginning, I came to Omaha in 1964 to work at Boys Town, Father Flanagan's home. It was way out in the country from Boys Town at then. 90th Street was the closest. In all the years that I've lived in Nebraska since then, I've seen a lot of growth in the city. Got married, three wonderful children, all live in the Omaha area. Omaha's been good to me. Omaha's been good to our family. My wife was born and raised in this town. She came from the South Omaha Projects. She was a nurse for many, many years. She loved Omaha. I love Omaha. And I would like to have Omaha continue to be the home for the people in District 6 and all of the people in Omaha to have the good home and place that I've had to live in all these years. Thank you.
Thank you. This concludes our forum for City Council Districts 1, 6, and 7, presented by the League of Women Voters. We'd like to thank all the candidates for participating this evening and answering questions. Also, the League would remind our viewers that we never endorse or oppose political parties or candidates, so we've presented this forum solely for educating our voters. We remind voters as well that the deadline for registering to vote in the primary election is March 17th by 5 p.m., I believe. That's by most methods, unless you go in person to the Douglas County Election Commission office. Then you have up until 5 p.m. on March 24th to register to vote. So please make sure you are registered. The primary election is on April 4th, the general election on May 9th. In addition to this forum, we will be on March 23rd doing a forum for City Council District 2, and then on March 30th, we will do Districts 3 and 4. All of our forums, once they have aired, will be available on our YouTube channel, and you can go to that channel directly from our League website, omahalwv.org. If you have questions you'd like to ask us, you have suggestions, you can also email us at omahalwv@gmail.com. And we certainly would appreciate questions and hearing from you about the forums. For the League of Women Voters, also we are doing a mayoral debate on Friday, April 14th, that is co-sponsored by the Omaha Press Club and with WOWT. And that will be aired at noon on Channel 6, WOWT. And we'll have that one also available later on our YouTube channel. The League of Women Voters appreciates all of our candidates participating, again, as we said. For the League of Women Voters of Greater Omaha, I'm Jerry Simon, reminding you to inform yourself about the issues and the candidates. And on Election Day, April 4th or May 9th, go vote, Omaha.